Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Wednesday edition of our morning briefing here at our convention headquarters. I'm Margaret Lowe Smith. I'm president of Atlantic Live, and our session this morning is called How Will They Govern? And we're going to try to answer the question, if Donald Trump wins the White House, how will he run the country? Who will be his key advisors, his cabinet, and how will he work with Congress? We're going to tackle the questions in a moment, but first, I just want to take a moment to thank our underwriters who've made This Week in Cleveland possible, the American Petroleum Institute's VoteForEnergy.org, Pasira, and Maker's Mark. For those of you on Twitter, we are at hashtag TheAtlanticRNC. Now let's get the conversation rolling. Please welcome Oklahoma Congressman Tom Cole. He's been in Washington for 30 years. Welcome, Congressman. Vin Weber was a congressman from Minnesota for 12 years in the House. He's now a partner with Mercury. It's a bipartisan strategic consulting firm. Mike Leavitt was the governor of Utah, then ran the EPA, and was Secretary of Health and Human Services under President George W. Bush. Welcome. Amy Walter is national editor of the Cook Political Report. Welcome, Amy.
Thank you.
And here to lead the conversation is my colleague, Ron Brownstein. He's senior editor at The Atlantic. He's here with the host of Face the Nation and the political director for CBS News, John Dickerson. Ron and John, take it away.
Margaret, thank you. Thank you, and it's great to be here with all of you, and especially with my my friend John Dickerson, the host of Face the Nation. Cinema buffs in the room will remember the classic final scene of The Candidate, where Robert Redford is elected senator from my state of California and turns to his political guru and says, what do we do now? That's the question that we are here to discuss this morning. If Donald Trump is elected president, what does he do now? Congressman Cole, let me start with you. Last night, Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan spoke at the convention. And while Senator McConnell listed a number of bills that Republicans had passed, Keystone, defunding Planned Parenthood, ending Obamacare, that he thought Donald Trump would sign, neither one of them in their remarks mentioned any of the signature initiatives that Donald Trump has run on. How difficult would it be to align the Donald Trump campaign agenda with the priorities of Republicans in the House and the Senate today?
Yeah, I don't think that difficult because they're still underneath a thrust. He's against regulation, he's for tax reform. So there's a lot of areas of commonality. And I think what Ryan has done very skillfully is lay out in the last few weeks and months what the Republican substantive policy alternatives would be. So I think those are the things that would begin moving. And beyond that, though, I think where if there was going to be a clash, where the real clash would tend to come is on deficit-related issues with entitlements. Yeah. Because, frankly, the next president, whether it's Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, is going to face a structural deficit that's only going to grow. And if you don't do something about it, you're going to be running for re-election with a rising deficit. Well, so that's where I'd see the differences.
Let me follow up, because I think both John and I want to talk about a number of areas that either Mr. Trump has talked about or congressional Republicans have talked about where it may be more difficult. And Vin, if I could follow up on Representative Cole's comments, Medicare is one of them. One of the signatures of Paul Ryan and the Republican Congress in the Paul Ryan era have been budgets that would convert Medicare into a premium support program. That has been a cornerstone of their vision of how to control the deficit over time. In May of Medicare, Donald Trump told Fox Business News, quote, I'm leaving it the way it is. Right. Do you expect that he would accept premium support, or do you think that that idea is done in a Donald Trump presidency?
It's a central issue. It's also the issue, the reason why Paul Ryan, if you remember, declined to endorse the Bowles-Simpson report. It had nothing to do with Democrats. Also, it's because he doesn't want to, because he wants to raise, doesn't want to raise taxes or something like that. It was because of the health care. It did not have a health care component. And that's logical for the guy in Congress who probably knows more about the budget than any other single person. It is impossible to deal with our long-term debt situation if you don't deal with health care and probably Social Security as well. So he's just stating a reality. Somebody at some point is going to have to change their mind about that. The bad news in this presidential election is, you know, we talk in this country about how the two parties never agree on anything. Well, yes, they do. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump and Hillary couldn't agree we should not deal with the long-term budget situation. Yeah. And, you know, we've achieved, you know, a bipartisan agreement that we're going to take this car over the cliff. So I have to believe at some point somebody just changes their mind and concedes. And if it's a part of a broader deal, I think Trump, the deal maker, might go along with it.
Governor Leavitt, you dealt with these issues at the HHS?
Absent from this campaign thus far has been a discussion really of the deficit. And I think if you saw a change in interest rates, that would change rapidly. And I think that would begin to change the issues surrounding Medicare. Once you begin to have the national bill for interest go up $600 or $700 or $800 billion, serious pressure on large deficits. We now have a very substantial part of the budget being devoted to both interest and paying for entitlements. I think that debate changes at that moment.
Mm-hmm. John?
Well, I want to go back to what Congressman Cole said, areas of commonality, but let's start with where things are actually going to begin should Donald Trump get elected. He's going to have to name somebody to the Supreme Court. That's going to begin a hot ideological fight right away. He's going to have to make good, at least at some level, on his two big promises, halting immigration, whether it's now been changed from halting Muslim immigration to halting immigration from terrorist areas, which are still ill-defined, then building a wall. Those are three hot fights right away. How are you going to ever get to entitlements and have a conversation that won't already be radioactive from those previous three fights?
Well, they're hot fights with the Democrats. They're not hot fights within the Republican Party. Look, border security is something that most Republicans agree on, period. And whether it's something as simplistic as a wall or, you know, more nuanced, doesn't much matter. There's broad said agreement, and that's very popular with the public. I think that's a pretty easy fight to win. You know, when you look at some of these other issues, again, Mr. Trump's essentially acceded to what the Republican House position is on the Muslim ban, which most people oppose because it's simply unconstitutional and unwise. You know, a lot of our best allies in the war on terror obviously are Muslims, you know, whether it's the Kurds on the ground or Turkey, where we fly a lot of our strikes out of, or King Abdullah, who's probably the best frontline leader, you know, and a great ally of the United States. So he's essentially, without admitting it, I think moved back to where the Republican House was. So those things won't be too tough. I think the bigger ones will be the entitlement fights because the numbers are the numbers, and you're going to end up with a rising deficit no matter what, unless the next president is willing to do something. And entitlement reform only comes with presidential leadership. It's just not possible to impose from a congressional level. So I think actually both of them will be forced to that position one way or the other.
Ben, pick up on this, but also let me add one other thing. I think border security, surely there's a consensus about border security, but border security is not the beginning and end of Donald Trump's immigration plan. There's a deportation of all 11 million or so that are here. That's where there's been a big clash. And one of the way people have found their way to get to yes with Donald Trump is they say he doesn't really believe all that. It's all negotiable. Right. Everything's negotiable, and in fact, Paul Manafort is essentially saying that now. So if everything's negotiable, well, sounds like a good guy to work with.
It's the first time that I can remember a candidate being sold on the basis of, you can trust this guy because you can't believe what he says, you know, and you hear it again and again and again. I think that the deportation issue, which we haven't talked a lot about because we talked about it so much earlier on in the campaign, is going to present people with a moral dilemma. Are we really going to appropriate money to round up and deport 11 million people, almost all of whom are living here peacefully, granted, not with papers, but peacefully and working at their jobs and not creating any harm for anybody else? I think that's a moral as well as an economic level. But let me add a fourth issue, John, that may be more immediate and in some ways more important than any, but we've kind of written it off, and that's the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think that's hugely important. I think it's hugely important as an economic issue, but even more so as a geopolitical issue. You look at the crisis that we have right now, depending on how China reacts to the recent World Court rulings about the South China Sea. And that part of the world is, you know, we tend to focus more on the Middle East because of Islamic extremism, but that part of the world is very near a crisis. And all of our allies there in the Pacific Rim are counting on us to engage in TPP. And again, I said a few minutes ago, there's no such thing as bipartisanship anymore. Oh, yes. The two candidates have agreed they're against TPP. You can't just allow that to die. It's too important. And so I don't know how we get it through. I don't know. Tom would know better than me. Can we do it in the lame duck session? Does the President Trump change his mind? I don't know. But that is an immediate problem with geopolitical consequences.
Amy, can I bring you in, kind of a jumping off of what Vin was saying, to a broader question, which is, win or lose, what is the imprint of Trump on congressional Republicans? Can they simply go back
to the old way
if it hadn't happened on things like issues like trade, immigration, entitlements? Go back to premium support, go back to supporting TPP, or do you think there would be a lasting imprint even if he doesn't win?
I do think that's the most fascinating thing about this election. It's not who's going to win, but what's going to happen to the party after this is over, win or lose for Donald Trump. What is the Republican Party? Right now, what we've seen from this convention is that this is the party of Trump, and we're watching as the different Republican factions are trying to figure out how they can fit into that. So what I was fascinated about, just in watching McConnell and watching Ryan, I mean, Paul Ryan gave a speech last night that was the same Paul Ryan speech that we've seen him give time and time again, as if Trump was not really a part of that, right? Like, I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. Yeah, this guy's up on the top of our ticket. Yeah, he could be president, but here's the agenda that I'm going to continue to push forward, making no concessions to what the Trump message has been all along and what his priorities have been all along. But it is pretty clear that this is a party right now that, well, I would actually argue the party's been divided probably since the time that you guys were there. I remember Mike Pence leading the charge against the Bush administration on No Child Left Behind, on expanding Medicare with Part D. And I would argue that the only thing that has kept this party from splintering before Trump's rise has been the deep dislike of Barack Obama. That's the only thing that sort of unified the party for these last 8 years. And so they were going to have to come to this reckoning anyway, whether it was Trump or not.
That may actually define the shape of the party. I have watched governors over many years. They fall into two big groups. There are those who see the job as being, you bring me things and I'll make decisions, or those who say, I have ideas and I want to implement them. It may surprise us that Donald Trump turns out to be a, you bring me things and I'll decide, and I just want to be president, and that the Congress really will dictate the agenda.
Well, let me ask, I want to follow up with President Cole, because you made an important point, I think, which is that the border security side of the Donald Trump immigration agenda probably has broad support in the party, but Vin raised the other. Donald Trump has repeatedly and explicitly promised that he's going to deport 11 million people. If he actually, and he has said he believes he can do that on his own authority without congressional approval. Probably can. So if he actually begins to do that, if he's elected president and he begins to, through a deportation force, remove people from the United States, what is the response of the Republican Congress? Do they accept it, or do you think there would be an effort to stop it?
I think, well, it depends on how you go about it. I mean, if you put border security front and center and say, we deal with this first, then we're going to deal with the 11 million people, I think, frankly, you'd find the American people are pretty compassionate once they think their borders are secure and there's a system set up. I think if you tried to do it from the get-go, I think you would run into a lot of opposition.
He's not talking about doing border security and then having a pathway of legal status. He's saying, I am going to remove them physically from the country. What would a Republican Congress do if that program actually began happening? Do you think it would be accepted, or would there be an effort to stop it?
I don't think it would be accepted whole scale. I mean, if you were, like, again, focusing on people that had committed crimes or things of that nature. But I think, the political reality is pretty quickly, and the economic reality, you're going to disrupt the economy pretty broadly if you start moving 11 million people out without much thought. It's not only their work, it's their markets, it's just, and most Americans might say things, but when you actually see police on the street pulling out neighbors or people going in and pulling people off work sites, I think that becomes something that most Americans say, no, fix the problem. The problem is the border. The problem is having some system here that doesn't reward people that have come illegally but extracts a fine, or, you've got to learn English for a background check or something like that. But I just think, full-blown deportation is not gonna sell politically, and I don't think a Republican Congress or any Congress would stand by and watch it happen.
John?
Vin, I've been struck that one of the other things we've seen in the differences between Donald Trump and, say, Paul Ryan is Paul Ryan believes in an idea. You put forward a set of plans. You have a big argument about them in the campaign. You use the campaign to make the case that you've now got a mandate to govern. And you then implement that mandate when you govern. Donald Trump seems to have a more improvisational view of things, although he does have these ideas that he that we've already talked about. How do you, and as Amy mentioned, you know, Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell last night basically treated Donald Trump as if he were a hand. Grover Norquist's old line, I don't really care who the president is just as long as he signs Paul Ryan's budget. So why is that? That seems to be an okay thing. If you like what's in those budgets, if you like what's being done in the Congress.
If that's the way things worked out, I'd be pretty happy. I mean, that's the positive outcome from
right.
my standpoint, a congressionally dominated Republican government in which the people like Tom Cole and Paul Ryan and folks like that deliver legislation to the president and he signs it. That may be the positive outcome we can all hope for. I think the other things we've been talking about are the problems. The handful of hot button issues where he has taken a very strong stand, like deportation, tearing up all of our trade agreements, pulling out of TPP and NAFTA, those are the problematic things. But in terms of him, of Congress delivering a Republican Congress delivering him a program, we could be sitting here, we could have several years ago, and say the problem there is there's no congressional program. We've solved that problem.
Right.
The House Republicans have got a governing agenda for a Republican administration. And the only question is, will he accept it?
Amy, what do you think the lessons would be if Donald Trump wins? Republicans now would think what about bucking their new... Let's say Donald Trump gets incredibly accommodationist, listens to Ryan and McConnell and starts to... We should note, by the way, Mitch McConnell, who delivered the Senate to the Republicans, was greeted with boos last night.
Well, there was a point at which he said... And we're going to keep the Senate. And it was crickets. You almost wanted to hear him go, please clap.
Yeah.
He's like, the Senate, come on, you guys. There was no desire.
And Speaker Ryan mentioned that he'd been the party's vice presidential nominee in 2012, and there was
almost zero
applause.
Right.
If I'm a member, Donald Trump wins, what lesson? And then let's say Donald Trump starts to go back on his promises, or he's not doing what he said he was going to do. How do you think do you just go along with Donald Trump because he won, or do you say, hey, he's breaking the promises that are a part of what's disappointed grassroots Republicans for a long time?
I guess I just want to pull back for a second because we're having this debate about what policies and how this is going to be implemented, and yet we've seen a candidate and a campaign that really seems to have no core ideology and is willing to switch their positions on issues pretty much on a whim. So we're going to ban Muslims. No, it's going to be territories. We're going to do this. Well, no, we're going to do that. I'm willing to negotiate anything. So this idea that there's this sort of core driving principles that he's going to, the second that he gets into office, push forward, I'm very skeptical of. This has been a policy-free campaign.
You don't think the immigration and trade side, the kind of, I'm going to protect,
well,
I'm going to protect American
part,
workers
exactly.
by holding the world back? You know, that seems pretty bedrock.
The TPP piece, which I would argue the ball had already been rolling on that, both with Trump and then, of course, on the Democratic side as well. And I agree, I think that was Vin's point about the two sides now are aligned on the trade issue. But as for whether this, I don't know that I'm convinced that Donald Trump's going to walk into office and say, these were the four things I campaigned on, and gosh darn it, I'm going to get through every one of these things before I move on.
Well, I would reassert that the conditions are setting up a circumstance where the Congress dictates the agenda, and that Trump will view himself as a person whom they need to negotiate with, and he'll begin to foster his own views or bend his own views around what's brought to him. And I think that's one of the things that's...
But he has also, let me ask you about that, because he has also asserted at various points a very expansive view of executive authority. I mean, he has talked about bringing back waterboarding. He has talked about deportation. He has talked about the temporary ban on Muslims or in any iteration. In each of those cases, he has indicated he believes he can do that without congressional approval.
So I'm thinking about a moment in the late November of 2008, and I'm sitting in the Oval Office with then-President George W. Bush. And we're having a conversation about the incoming new administration. And he said, Barack Obama is going to find out this is harder than it looks. And I think Donald Trump is going to find out this is harder than it looks.
Speaking can I jump on that, since you've paid some attention to transitions in your life, Governor, can you talk a little bit about that? All presidents complain. They've got this incredible, powerful job, and they, at the end of it, even Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, talk about how constrained they were in the end. Truman said of Eisenhower, you know, he's going to tell him, you know, give an order and nobody's going to listen. Can you explain, give us the expectations for what it's like for either president that comes in, but obviously we're talking in the Trump context, of what really can get done, of where the real power is in a presidency and where, you know, where there isn't?
Well, start with the first job, which is putting a team on the field. If Donald Trump were to get 100 people through Congress confirmation, through all of the processes and into senior leadership places, positions in the first 100 days, he would set a world's record.
Yeah.
There just is very little support in those first 200 days. You can also look at history and see that any president that does not establish first a budget, their budget priorities and the initiatives that they campaigned on between Inauguration Day and the August recess never gets them done. So this has to happen very quickly. And if you haven't thought through what it is, A, you believe, and B, you want to get it accomplished, those 100 days go by very quickly. The second 100 day goes by even more quickly. And we're off to then a discussion about midterm elections.
Yep. Right. So just to follow up, how would you compare, you handled the transition planning for Governor Romney, how would you compare where, as far as you know, the Trump campaign is today on transition planning relative to where you were in 2012?
Well, Governor Christie's been appointed as their chairman. They have a formal process I know that's in place. I don't know a lot about where they are in that process. Mm-hmm. But this requires a substantial amount of effort. You need to start in April or May to be ready in order to do the things that I've laid out.
One more question to stick in this area, and then maybe, John, if you want to come jump back in. Vin, to say the least, this has been an unconventional campaign in the sense that most of the Republican policy establishment, particularly in the foreign policy side, has conspicuously kept their distance from Donald Trump. If he does win, what would a Trump, do you have any sense of, what would a Trump administration look like? Who would would everybody rally around, and you see kind of the you know, established experts coming in, or do you think it would be a very different cast of characters?
I think that's a big and negative question, because you've seen more people from the foreign policy world literally saying they're going to support Hillary Clinton. I mean, there are a lot of Republicans that are uncomfortable with Trump, but they haven't quite said that. Some of the foreign policy people, like Brent Scowcroft, have said they're going to support Hillary Clinton. My friend Ken Adelman said he's going to support Hillary Clinton. There's a whole bunch of them. And there may be more, and it's because they're uncertain about a lot of these things. The approach to Russia, what I mentioned, what TPP does to the Far East, the relationships with the Muslim world, a whole range of things. You have to hope between now and the election that he will begin surrounding himself with some of those people that will feel more comfortable if they just have some input into it. One of the things that concerns me, Governor Leavitt ran the transition for Governor Romney. I was involved in the policy team, and you can speak to this better than I can, Governor, but we had hundreds and hundreds of people that were advising at various levels on all sorts of policy issues, some great big ones, some very narrow ones, all people that had been vetted at least to the extent that we knew they were supporters of Governor Romney, they had some expertise, and that's a good place to start putting an administration together. It doesn't end the process, but it's a good start. I don't know that there's anything like that with this administration, with this candidate.
So I think you can, a scenario is shaping here with the incapacity of a Trump administration to implement an agenda, either because of lack of preparation and lack of team, and then a House and that's better prepared than it has ever been. What we're likely to see in a Trump presidency is, at least in the first 200 days, is the agenda will be driven by the House.
But given those kind of... Okay, John.
Well, no, I was going to say, maybe we're in the same, to Congressman Cole. If I heard that, and I was a member of Congress and I was worried about Donald Trump, I'd be so excited because it would mean the following.
Yeah, right.
He's not going to have his game together enough to really force any of these things on us. He's going to want to accomplish things. And boy, that's going to give us a lot of power to put legislation in front of him. He'll want to have a win. He'll have to sign it. So being in Congress is going to, you know, it's going to mean, for those who might be a little frustrated over the last few years, it's going to really mean something again.
Well, I agree with that, frankly. And I think that's, if he's successful, likely to be what happens. Because, you know, we've got a set of ideas and that we're ready to move. And I think he's unlikely to have that. And they're not, again, ideas that are necessarily at odds with his core positions. So, you know, you just push through, so to speak. It's a lot easier to take policy off the shelf sometimes and think it up yourself.
Right.
And what Paul Ryan's done is put policy on the shelf. Now, again, it's ultimately the president's choice if he wants to pursue it. But a lot of, he's going to like the tax reform piece. He's going to like the deregulatory piece.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think at the end of the day, when he really sits and looks at the budget deficit, if you think you're going to balance it without dealing with entitlements, that's just a fantasy. You can't. So at the end of the day, you're going to look at Paul Ryan's entitlement policy ideas and say, you know, that makes sense, and at least I've got the votes to pass them, because he's actually moved budgets across the floor with people willing to, you know, run great political risk and vote for these things.
Right.
I just jump in. I want to kind of get also to Ron's point about, you know, is this changing the party and what does it mean for Congress, which is, you know, can this Congress also meet where Trump has brought many new people in, which is there is a populist fervor and there is a desire for Congress to actually pass stuff that addresses their deep-seated need to see actual change in their lives. That what are you guys going to do in Congress that's going to help me feel like the economy is coming back for people like me, that the jobs are going to come back, that this idea that in America, whatever, in whatever form, but especially the economic powerhouse America, is going to come back to life. And it just seems to me that passing tax reform and deregulation isn't getting to the heart of the bigger Trump message, which is really making a the average middle-class American who has felt stuck and their wages have been stagnating for a generation whole again.
The flip side of that, Vin, is that Trump has been an unusual degree of conflict with the business community, describing the chamber as a collection of special interests.
Yep.
The business roundtable and the chamber and much of the business community have been an absolute bulwark for that Republican majority in Congress since the 1990s, the K Street Project and on and on. What would you expect relationship, and you certainly work in the business community now, what would relationships be like between the business leadership and the Republican Party under a Donald Trump presidency?
I think the relationship between the business community and the Republicans in Congress will get really, really strong.
Really strong.
Because I think the administration is likely going to be somewhat less accessible, maybe a lot less accessible, maybe by Trump's desires. This may be because they don't have people that have dealt with that community, but the relationship with the Congress is going to get much stronger, which buttresses, I think, what Governor Leavitt has said.
But is that, they would get stronger as really as a way of checking the Republican president? Is that what you're saying? Or because they think?
Well, I don't know that the business community, other than on the trade issue, which I keep coming back to because I think it's important. Well, and immigration is a little different. We've had problems on immigration for a long time, even within the Republican Party. Trade is relatively new. But beyond that, I think I'm agreeing with Tom Cole. I don't think the business community has a lot of deep disagreements with a potential President Trump on regulation or taxation or issues like that. I think that they may have problems of access because he has been so vigorously anti-establishment, anti-business community, anti-Washington, things like that. I think that they'll be able to work together. Can I go one?
Yeah.
Can I back up a little bit?
Yeah, yeah.
Amy backed us up once, I'm going to back us up again.
One
of the big problems I think we've got to think about as a country is how a president and a Republican Congress, if that's what happens, could begin to turn around public opinion about the direction of our country. Because I think it's more difficult. Because all of us are kind of policy-oriented people, we say, well, all right, we've got these problems with income disparity and stagnant incomes and lack of upward mobility, and if we push policy levers A, B, C, D, and E, we finally get that done, things will be better. 67% of the people in the country think we're on the wrong track. This is Amy's area. You can correct me if I'm wrong on the numbers.
Yeah.
And it's a majority or plurality have thought we're on the wrong track for 12 years.
Yeah.
That's through Republican Congresses, Democrat Congresses, Republican presidents, Democrat presidents. That's through successes in policy like No Child Left Behind, the prescription drug benefit, the passage of Obamacare, and failure of policies like the shutdown of government and things like that. I think that we need to dig a lot deeper to understand why it is that people think we're fundamentally on the wrong track. And it really scares me to think that we could have a new president coming in with a new mandate, and 6 months down the road, the country that says another failed attempt. Because we don't understand what the real fear people have is. It's more than just economic, I think.
And because, indeed, it is harder than it looks.
Yeah.
Governor, we touched on this a little bit before, but let's talk about the foreign piece of this. The domestic piece, a president who doesn't quite have their act together yet when they get in office has, as the congressman said, there are plans on the shelf. You might have to put them in luxurious binders, but they would be you'd be able to use those plans on the shelf. But foreign policy, a president is alone. I mean, has advisors, but a president sits alone. Talk a little bit about that and what a new president would face, a new President Trump would face, because you can't really outsource that to Congress. You're alone in the office, the decisions are yours, and we've talked already about how a lot of the foreign policy establishment in Washington is going elsewhere. So give us a sense of what foreign policy would look like for a new president.
Well, I think that's the worry that many have. It isn't that domestic policy. There are checks and balances in domestic policy. When you order when you put into order the people that you need to put on the team, you start with the White House staff, you start with the chief of staff, you go to the national, then you go to the National Security Council and you put the foreign policy team together second. That indicates the importance of that because literally on day one, the codes go to the president and the capacity to literally shape and reshape global policy falls to that office. And I do think that Vin is correct. There's been a lot of those who would traditionally have experience in that area who understand the nuances. And there's so much nuance to that area. And by the way, it's a very complicated area because it's a group of people who don't necessarily agree and they love to not agree with each other. And so actually being able to choose a team that has compatibility between the State Department and the Defense Department and the National Security Council and that will work together and that won't create discord inside that community is an important component.
We're going to bring in the audience for questions in a minute, but I'd like to ask kind of a final thought before we do, and then John and I will take it back for some final questions. Vin, you have been a skeptic of Donald Trump and his long-term impact on the party in a diversifying country. And I'm interested in your thought, and I'd love to get Amy to weigh in on this as well. Given kind of the underlying demographic changes in the country, what is a greater long-term risk to the Republican Party? That Donald Trump loses this year or that he wins and implements the agenda that he's running on? What would you worry about
I could have completed your question before you began it. That worries me a great, great deal. Let me say, you're right, I'm a deep skeptic about Donald Trump. I'm not a skeptic about the notion that the Republican Party is the natural majority for a country that is changing in the way our country is. I really believe that. I believe the Democratic Party is moving to the left. I believe governing this country from the left over a long period of time is not going to be feasible. But it means we have to be a competitive party with the emerging demographics, and we've all talked about that ad infinitum. So I'm very worried about a president who gets into power and pursues policies that make it impossible for us to broaden the Republican Party's appeal to those naturally conservative communities that exist within the African American community, the Hispanic community, the Asian community. These are not politically homogenous groups. There are a lot of conservative voters within all of those communities. I remember we did some polling way back in the 1980s on the African American community. We divided it into three areas: social policy, economic policy, and national security policy. And we found that a third of African Americans were conservative on all three areas. You would think that would mean that about a third of African American voters were at least theoretically available to the Republican Party. The party has to be able to compete for those votes in order to govern. And I really believe, I don't want to be apocalyptic, I think that if Trump becomes president and can't transform himself in a way that allows the Republican Party to become the natural center-right majority in this country, I think the two-party system itself is going to fall apart, at least for a time being.
This convention in and of itself, I think, answers your question, Ron, which is there is absolutely nothing about the program, the speakers, and the messaging that says we are a Republican Party that wants to reach out and bring new people in. It has been, it has been a convention of aggrievement, and mostly of white aggrievement politics. And I think that this is the kind of stuff that is going to sit out there for a long time, long past Trump. That speech that Pat Buchanan gave in 1992 set the Republican Party back, I would argue, as a party that was socially intolerant. And I think it limited the Republican Party's ability to go with the changing cultural tide, especially on gay rights issues, the role of women. And they haven't been able to come back from that.
Tom?
Well, those are pretty tough questions for a practicing politician to answer. But I think in the long run, numbers drive reality. I agree very much with what Vin says. Look, one of my star clients when I used to run campaigns was a guy named J.C. Watts, who everybody here will know. And J.C. wasn't a Republican until 11 months before he was elected to office. But he was a conservative his entire life, from a conservative family with a conservative set of values. I think there are a lot of those kind of people out there. And I think the numbers in the end usually make parties bend toward the electorate. And the numbers here are going to force the Republican Party over time, I think, to become more diverse, more tolerant, and frankly, more open to other voices. We see some of that happening, by the way, at the state levels. In a lot of states, governors are usually ahead of the curve and adopting to their electorates. Yep. They're doing that. And we're beginning to see more diversity inside the ranks in Congress than we used to have. You know, we have Native American members, African American members, Jewish American members, in places where we didn't have them before. So I think locally that is occurring. And the one thing I'll say about Donald Trump, and I don't know him, I've never met him personally, but look, I don't, he's pretty pragmatic in running his business, and he seems to promote talent from within. And there seems to be a lot of people in his business that think he's a heck of a good boss. So I think in the end, he's going to look for people to try and get the job done. And, you tend to govern a little bit different sometimes than you run. I think he would probably govern differently in that particular area.
John, do you want to button up anything on here before you go to the audience?
No, I think we'll go to
the audience. All right, let's go to the audience. We've got a question in the front.
Thank you.
Just identify yourself, please.
Hi, yes, Tim Carney with the Washington Examiner, and I want to follow up on Amy's point about the working class. Do you think the Republicans will take a lesson or should take a lesson from Trump's success and give something to the working class, whether it's changing the approach on immigration or on trade or in any other way, or do you think sort of the deregulation tax cutting that is the typical Paul Ryan agenda can appeal to them?
Can I take a shot at that? I actually think we can and should, and I think there's a lot of thinking going on. And there are ways that are perfectly consistent with our policies to take into account those kind of concerns. Let's start with entitlement reform. Entitlement reform can be done in such a way that the average working American who pays, on every cent of income he makes, Medicare and Medicaid taxes and Social Security, can get a little cut there. And yet you could still shore up the systems by making those, frankly, that are very wealthy and that use the system. Warren Buffett doesn't need exactly the same Social Security plan and entitlement or Medicare plan that Ma and Pa Kettle do that only have Social Security. So you can address things that way. You can look at the minimum wage if you do it coupled, as we did during the Bush years, with tax cuts for businesses that offset particularly small businesses that can be heavily impacted by this. So there's a variety of things that we have sort of forgotten about. Remember when we did tax cuts back when you were in Congress, we limited some of those to people less than $95,000 a year. That was a Republican idea. The child tax credit was a Republican initiative. Those are things that helped average working people. Bill Clinton got a lot of credit for them because he signed them, but the ideas came up from Republican Congress.
Right. We have a question over here.
Hi, my name is Anna. I'm a Mexican journalist for Televisa. And, well, you've been talking about checks and balances, and you've been talking about how hard that governing is harder than it looks. I just wanted to ask, really, because I read Andrew Sullivan's piece in The Atlantic talking about America being closer to fascism than ever before, and how you cannot really rely on checks and balances when you have somebody like Donald Trump on the ticket. So I just wanted to ask if you are really confident on U.S.'s checks and balances.
I think our system is pretty resilient. I understand the concern. I spoke to a business conference in Monterey the day after the Indiana primary, which was when Donald Trump lined up the nomination and John Kasich withdrew. And I had a lot of questions like the one you just asked from very concerned Mexicans who thought they had, by the way, the best relationship with America in any of their lifetimes, and suddenly they had a candidate running essentially, in their view, against Mexico. But I think, you know, I'm concerned about his authoritarian tendencies. But we have a very strong system. The Congress is not going to go away. The courts are not going to go away. The Constitution is not going to go away. So I would, even though I'm nervous about him as a leader, I think you can have confidence that our country is going to be okay.
Let's see. Over here? Yeah. Sorry, I guess I'm in the back. Next, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, hi, this is Sean Kiefer with Pearson. One of the questions, obviously, is Trump-centric, but obviously he chose Mike Pence as the running mate. And although he's not as strong of a character, he has a, back to the 100 or 200 days, he does have a lot of in-depth experience and networks in the Congress. So really, in regard to that negotiation or savvy going in, what do you see the role of Mike Pence in on the congressional side, not as much on the campaign side?
Yeah. Well, potentially very, very important. Because frankly, he's known and liked. You know, we all know him as a principled conservative. We all know him as a guy. I love one of the things he likes to say is, "I'm a conservative, but I'm not mad about it." We need a lot more of that kind of conservatism. He's very Reagan-esque in his approach. So I think he's the natural emissary to the Hill. He'd be met with open arms. So I think Mike can really shape things, and he was very reassuring. And to be fair, the last three choices were pretty reassuring because they were pretty traditional. Chris Christie, Newt Gingrich, Mike Pence. Those are people that we can sit and parse one way or another as to who would be the best, but nobody would have been uncomfortable with any of them that's in office today because they're known quantities. We know how they've governed. We know how they vote. And I think Mike would be really, really good emissary if he gets that role.
Let's bring in the bleacher seats. We have a question from the bleachers.
Great. Paul Sherman with TechWire Media. I had a question. We've been talking a lot about the House, but how would Senate Democrats respond to a Trump presidency? And I just think of Obama with almost 60% or 60 Senate members had a tough enough time getting his agenda through. And with the filibuster, what yeah. makes you think that the Senate would go ahead and rubber stamp the House and maybe a Trump agenda?
Tom Cole.
Well, the Senate doesn't rubber stamp anything, anytime, for any president. So I think they would have a role to play. What worries me the most is the nature of this campaign is such that whoever loses, it's going to be pretty easy to be unrelentingly hostile to the winner. And neither side has shown the tendency to reach out at all to the other side. So the vote no is just the easiest thing to do. At the end of the day, though, the problems are such that a new president is going to face a structural deficit. So you're going to have some buy-in from the other party to do entitlement reform. You can't do it on your own. You do have this complex set of security threats, and you do have a country that is over-regulated tremendously. So, there's some hope there, but I wouldn't expect the Democrats to give in. They certainly didn't give in before. And for those of you that have doubts about checks and balance, ask either of the last two presidents whether or not there are checks and balances. They'll tell you right away, yeah, there are real checks and balances. And the key is to find enough people on the other side to get something done.
The new Senate Democratic leader will be better than the old one. Yeah. from everybody's perspective.
Absolutely true.
But Amy, going back to Congressman Cole's point about the poisonous nature of this campaign, let's say Donald Trump is the president, which has been the premise of this conversation. If I'm a Democrat and I do anything to cooperate with him, a man who's been described in such extraordinary Absolutely. Terms by Democrats, the entire grassroots Democratic machine
Wouldn't
people will rise up and yeah. call and punish you for capitulating and dealing with a man who's been described as such evil. And of course, the truth, same
the truth is
going to
be on
Clinton
the same side. And that's
were.
What I was just going to say. Yeah. Is you're now in this bind where I do believe in Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell and Schumer, Pelosi. I think these are four people who can make and want to cut deals. I think if you put them in the room and they could argue back and forth, but ultimately come up with a deal, they don't have anybody that would follow them with that deal. So, you know, the talk has been about the lack of leadership. I think the problem isn't the leaders. I think the problem is the people who are supposed to be the followers.
Let me segue that into a closing question for the governor and maybe even in Representative Cole. The scenario here is Donald Trump is president, but there is the possibility that she who shall not be named could also be president. In that, for the purposes of Cleveland Voldemort scenario, what do you think relationships would be like between a President Hillary Clinton and a Republican House, at least? Would they be able to work together?
I think we would fall into the traditional pattern of we will get things done when we have to, and when we don't, we won't.
Mm-hmm. Ben?
I think that's a fair statement. I think in some ways she could be easier to work with than the president has been, because I actually see her position to his left when you actually look at her record over a period of time. But for us, the great unknown is she really against TPP? Because we don't really think she is. Right. We think she's adopted a lot of positions from a campaign standpoint. She really not understand that we need to deal with entitlements in some substantive way? We think she does. So I just don't know which Hillary Clinton we're going to be dealing with, Senator Hillary Clinton, Secretary Hillary Clinton, or President Hillary Clinton.
Van, a final word on this? What would it look
like? Well, no, all I would say, the storyline seems to be that at the grassroots level, the Republicans just hate Hillary Clinton. They all want her in jail, blah, 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 blah. Maybe so. Not true in the Congress. The people that served with Hillary Clinton in the Congress as Republicans got along with her, respected her, and worked with her. Didn't agree with her, don't want her to be president, but the notion that she will come in hated by everybody in the Congress is simply not an accurate statement. Mm-hmm.
A great, interesting thought on which then.
Thank you.
Great to be here with my friend John Dickerson. Thank you all for being here. And now Margaret is going to take us to our next panel.
Thank you, John. Thank you, everybody. The next topic is how would a President Trump communicate? A key part of governing is the ability to do that swiftly and effectively. We've all seen Donald Trump on the Trump campaign trail. We know he can get his message out pretty swiftly. He even announced his running mate in 140 characters. So how would that translate to the White House? To help us decode this question, we have three people who've spent their lives honing the art of communication. Alex Conant is the former communications director for Marco Rubio's campaign and now a partner at Firehouse Strategies, a public affairs consulting firm. Mindy Finn is a digital media strategist. She's done work for both Mitt Romney and George W. Bush. She's now a senior advisor to IMGE, a firm that specializes in designing digital campaigns. And Josh Holmes is the president of Cavalry, a crisis communications and strategic consulting firm. He was chief of staff to Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. My colleague, Atlantic senior editor Alex Wagner, is here to lead this conversation. Alex.
Thank you guys all for caffeinating with us. So let's get right to it. January 21st, 2017. I'll start with you, Alex, because we share the same name. Yeah. Also because I love your thoughts. What does President Trump's communication strategy look like?
Well, I would imagine that if he were elected president, his communications as president would look similar to what it's been as a candidate, which is all about Trump. That is, he's not gonna do a lot to promote surrogates within his administration to promote other spokespeople to go out and speak on his behalf. Instead, I think you would see him engaging with the press a lot, engaging on social media a lot, doing a lot of press conferences, giving a lot of speeches, kind of like he's been doing as president. And frankly, that's not all that dissimilar from how Barack Obama has approached communications in the White House. I think Obama's faults as a communication, or rather his administration's faults as when it comes to communications, is their failure to promote surrogates and spokespeople from within. He doesn't have a lot of high-profile members of his cabinet. And so as a result, a lot of the heavy lifting when it comes to delivering a message from his administration falls to the president himself. I would expect to see more of that in the Trump administration.
That doesn't necessarily sound like you think it's a successful communication strategy.
Well, it's not, because you leave a lot of on the field when you when you're not using all of the tools in the administration, when you don't have cabinet secretaries that are high profile, that you have lead initiatives on things. You're not using all of the tools at your disposal in the administration.
Josh, what of the social media strategy of the Trump administration? I mean, this is someone who's notorious. I mean, this is as much a plank of his campaign as anything else. Yeah. How does that, what happens on social media if Trump is elected president from the, you know, at Donald Trump handle?
You said the word strategy, which I'm not sure totally applies here. I do think, picking up on what Alec just said, I totally agree. I think you could envision a scenario where he gives his own daily press conferences, right? I think his spontaneity is sort of what has endeared him most to those who are most committed to Donald Trump. And if you were to win the presidency, I don't see him going away from that, right? I mean, that's for all of us who have thought everything that he's done has been sort of a misstep, and he's gone away from conventional wisdom of ways to succeed. You know, I mean, if he succeeds, despite that, he's going to think that we're all, you know,
wrong,
and he's all right, and I have no reason to believe he would change, right? So, I think a social media presence. I mean, it's the one way to go beyond the media filter, which of course he loves to demonize the media, and go directly to your voters. And I think that gives him a platform that maybe previous presidents haven't had, in a way to directly to deliver that message.
Mindy, I sort of think that we have crossed the Rubicon as far as, well, the way we understand the media and a traditional campaign and what candidates have to do or what they don't have to do. Do you think, in terms of, let's talk specifically about Twitter, has Trump changed that medium for every candidate in the future?
I think he has, potentially. You know, I think you have to keep in mind that coming into this campaign, while he was someone that many people underestimated, pretty much everyone underestimated, probably in this room, he came in with millions of Twitter followers that no candidate who was running could match. You know, he had a big brand that he's established for 40 years, but there are people who have that brand that may not have been playing on a platform like Twitter. He did. And so he was able to use it really effectively as a megaphone to kind of drop a, you know, I would call it like a stink bomb every day, that would then diffuse and drive the news cycle, because outrage sells, you know, negativity sells, conflict, and he would drive cable news for 24, 48 hours, and if it started to die down, he would drop something else.
I want to talk about the outrage quotient, Alex, because I know that Marco Rubio, for example, sort of tried to play in the same sort of sandbox, if you will, through humor, through bombast, whatever, at certain points in the campaign. And a lot of folks thought that didn't work. What are the lessons learned for other candidates and other politicians who want to venture into the territory that Donald Trump has opened up?
Well, that's a really good question. So I've been involved in every presidential election since 2008. I was the RNC's press secretary in 2008. I worked on Tim Pawlenty's campaign in 2012, and then obviously Rubio's this cycle. And I was struck this cycle at how much communications has changed, and how much political communications, and I assume the same is true for corporate and other forms of communication, has changed in just the last 4 years. I mean, 4 years ago, Facebook was a thing, but it wasn't what you woke up in the morning thinking about. And now, as a communicator, more of our target universe got their news from Facebook than they did from their daily newspaper in the morning. And Facebook doesn't have deadlines. Facebook doesn't work on news cycles. Facebook is a constant stream of information, as is Twitter, just a constant stream of information. And so you can't just put out a press release on Friday afternoon and assume that that extinguishes a problem if you're trying to, you know, bury a news. Because the news cycle as we knew it in 2012, let alone in 2008, no longer exists. So I think when you talk about Marco and some of the tactics we used towards the end, it is very hard to capture people's attention in the current media environment where you're competing for space on Twitter and on Facebook profiles, trying to get people to like and share content. That means you have to create a ton of content, and you have to create it in a continuing basis and in an interesting way. Trump is the master at that. I mean, Trump produces a lot of content. And now it's not in the form of traditional political communications like policy speeches or op-eds or TV commercials even. It's rallies, it's interviews, it's tweets. It's sort of the unpredictable, but it works for him. And I think other politicians, if they want to be successful in the modern communications era, need to emulate some of what Trump has done in terms of producing a lot of content in an interesting way that engages audiences. That doesn't mean you have to set your hair on fire like Trump does every day.
Right.
As we did towards the end, make jokes that were off brand that my boss later regretted making. But it does mean that you can't just put out a 30-second ad once a week and assume that that is going to carry your message. You need to engage the media online and in an ongoing and consistent way.
Pull back the curtain a little bit, though, because I'm eager. I mean, when we think about Trump and his social media presence, a lot of that is generated from the candidate himself. We hear he dictates tweets. Mm-hmm. When you guys were doing this and trying to sort of master the alchemy of that sort of social media catnip, how did you put it together? Would you discuss the sort of voice?
Well, yeah, I mean, unlike Trump, which I think is largely a one-man show, I mean, we had a campaign. And so we had a team, we had a social media department, we had a media department, we produced TV ads, we engaged our audience and our supporters online. We had our biggest department in the campaign was our social media department.
Right.
Because we would engage people, we produced a ton of content. And I think online, if you go to our website, we were producing more content than any of the other campaigns because we wanted people to share our content. And it worked. I mean, we were getting more traffic to our website towards the end of the campaign than a lot of major news outlets. And if I wanted to make news, oftentimes I would just make it on our news site, knowing that our supporters and social media would then share with their supporters, and we would reach our target audience in a much more efficient way than, you know, giving an interview to the New York Times in many cases. So, I mean, we try to do it. Now, look, there is a balance between setting your hair on fire and doing something that's on brand. And I think every politician is going to struggle. Heck, Donald Trump has struggled with that. I mean, Trump has said stuff that he's later regretted saying because it's been counterproductive.
And retweeted things that I'm sure he
precisely
his campaign precisely
and his campaign has done things, you know, tweeting and retweeting symbols and whatnot that he clearly was not a part of and did not support after the fact or did not approve after the fact. So I think it's something that every campaign struggles with. We're in a transition in communications right now. I think the Clinton campaign is going to struggle with it in the general election. And I don't have an answer to that other than you need to be very aware of what your own brand is. And if you do something that's off brand, it's going to come across as phony and weird and damaging. And so Trump had an advantage in this campaign because entering it, people saw him as a businessman and an outsider and somebody who said provocative things.
Right, so he was a provocateur from the beginning.
He had a much longer leash than any of the other candidates. I mean, if any of the other candidates who were seen as politicians said things that he said, it would have been deemed, out of place and off brand and not authentic, and they would have taken a lot of criticism for him. And it would have been counterproductive. I think Trump's challenge is that now people are starting to look at him as a potential president. I mean, we've shifted from he's a business guy to now he could be president of the United States, and people have a different expectations for the president of the United States than they do for a celebrity entertainer.
Mindy, on that note, are Trump's tweets getting more professional? I mean, I know we talked a lot about the six-pointed star in a couple weeks, but if you go back and you look at recent tweets, they're much less sort of bombastic than they have been. Is that evidence?
Yeah, there's a lot that you can learn in his tweets beyond what the actual words are. You often can tell his mood. You can tell who's actually controlling the account. You can tell that it's the middle of the night and he kind of goes off on a rant. That has been walked back to some extent. And, you know, you can tell if you look closely when it seems to be a campaign staffer who's carefully calculated and packaged a message versus something that Trump dictated and said, we absolutely need to say this. The other thing that's happened, though, as the campaign has become larger and more professionalized and they get into this phase, is that staffers, they've started to learn his voice. They've learned, they've adopted his style. They believe it works. And so there's kind of the, You know, if you look at the format of kind of saying crooked Hillary is this sad or loser, you know,
sad,
these kinds of things.
Sad exclamation point.
Sad. Yeah, sad. So it's become a Trump Twitter style. But I think that would be the really interesting question for him as a president. I mean, typically you've had presidents not even be able to use email or the internet. How would a President Trump handle that? I don't know. Would he allow for that? I mean, technically it's not something that he should be doing. But if that brand starts to be subdued somehow, and he doesn't the same kind of celebrity and, you know, entertainer have the popularity he has on those platforms, would he want to take more control back over?
So, Josh, that does bring to mind a sort of tension between a candidate. Some candidates are not comfortable on social media. Others understand it. Donald Trump has an intrinsic understanding. He understands the id of social media in a way that I think a lot of other people don't. How do you control a president who says, I want to send this tweet out? How do you control any politician who wants to sort of control their social media in an age when it can become something explosive?
Well, I think with almost any form of communications, what a candidate under those circumstances or a president under those circumstances needs most is a strong manager or a strong chief of staff or somebody who has the ability to say no. I don't know that we have that entirely with Trump yet. We might. He seems to be more disciplined than he used to be, and I fewer late night tweets, perhaps, less sad exclamation points,
right?
And a little bit more message discipline. He's trending in that direction, but look, any candidate or potential president, an actual president, benefits most by somebody in the room who has the ability to say, you know, look, that's not a good idea, right? And social media is the ultimate practice for that. Right. Every time you sit down at a computer and you're working on something you want to post online, if you have a moment where you say, this might not be a good idea, it's not a good idea.
Right.
Right? It's just, it's not.
Do you think Trump has come around to that sort of giving himself that pot? Well, so let's talk specifically about Donald Trump. I mean, because if there is a Trump administration, I mean, how does anyone say Donald, let's vet the tweet? I mean, that even saying vet the tweet to Donald Trump seems like an anathema.
Yeah, I mean, up until this point, that's been an impossible proposition, right? I mean, I think we've all watched as this evolution has taken place of him trying to run a more professional campaign. And I think somebody, I think, look, I don't know Paul Manafort, but it seems to me like he's had some influence here. There's been less 1 a.m. tweets. There's been less provocative stuff out there. The question is ultimately, if he really is dead set on something, whether there's anybody in the room who can say, stop. And that is any candidate or any president's best asset.
It depends, just quickly, on that, what you're aiming for. So in the primary, he's used to aiming for ratings,
right,
and eyeballs and attention.
Right.
So can they make the shift to recognizing that, yeah, I mean, he's going to need a platform, but as a president, you have the bully pulpit, you have that platform. He's not in that same kind of competition anymore. And now communication isn't just about, can I get the most eyes and ears on
right.
me? It's, can I bring the country along? Can I bring Congress along? Can I? So I think that's going to be interesting to see how they navigate that shift.
On that note, Alex, the current president, President Obama, has in many ways vaulted over the head of traditional media. He's doing interviews, you know, with YouTube stars. Mm-hmm. He has taken his message, I mean, Between Two Ferns with Zach Galifianakis was seen as one of the sort of high points of his media strategy, insofar as it delivered on numbers for the ACA, if you listen to what the administration says. Is that now the model for the American presidency, that not only do you sort of have to play footsie with the New York Times, but you also need to be blanketing, you know, you need to make BuzzFeed videos that will go viral and sit down with Glozell Green?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. And I know President Obama has taken a lot of heat from conservatives for some of the interviews that he's done because they've seemed, in the words of conservatives, unpresidential. My attitude is, if you want to reach people, you need to go to where people are. And that means you need to engage them on the mediums and the medias that they are engaged with. And so I think when I worked for Marco Rubio, we were the first politician in the country to go visit BuzzFeed's headquarters because I realized what they were doing, which was
trying to— Did you plant a flag there, like the Rubio flag? Like, claim the Arctic.
We snuck in and we snuck out in the dead of the night. But we were the first politician to go there, and we tried very hard to engage people where they were. We did late night shows. We did a lot of interviews with bloggers and online media, non-traditional media, Hispanic media. And I think that's, if you're the president of the United States, you cannot just rely on the 20 media organizations that are represented in the press briefing room every day, because most Americans, or many Americans, don't get their news from them. And frankly, if you're an average American, you get most of your news on Facebook right now, and the links that you're tapping on are not necessarily the New York Times. I mean, they're going to be everything from Breitbart to Huffington Post to websites people in this room haven't even heard of. And so I think it's very important that you go to those places, you engage those mediums. And I think I give the Obama administration a lot of credit for being bold in that aspect.
Let me ask one philosophical question before we go to the audience, Josh. In an age where, as Alex points out, you have to be comfortable in all of these different mediums, does that lead to a self-selection of certain kinds of candidates? I mean, we ask for steady hands, people with deep knowledge, people with the ability to forge compromise and get things done, right? That is a certain sort of mindset, right, and a certain sort of CV. Then we also ask for people who are comfortable doing YouTube videos and BuzzFeed, that is a distinctly different skill set. Do they intersect?
It's a really great question. Actually, I think that's one of the most unique aspects of a new media world, which is, have we matured enough here to get people of deep, substantive, thoughtful leadership that also have the ability to transition on a dime and walk out to YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and the social media and communicate in that forum? I don't think we're there yet. I think some people are, you look at some of the younger politicians, there are some sort of first-term senators who are very uniquely good at this. I think over time, this becomes absolute rock solid fact. Like, if you succeed in politics, you have to have these two things. I think we're at a sort of an apex right now. We haven't quite made it on the other side of the hill. So everybody who's good at the first part may not have the second part. And I think that just comes with time, the maturity of the
form. They'll age into being Twitter stars.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at all the first-term senators, Cory Gardner, Ben Sasse, folks like that, Tom Tillis, literally all of them have that. None of their colleagues do, which is an interesting component.
That's a new model.
Yeah, right. And Marco Rubio is another one that has that.
He planted a flag in BuzzFeed.
That's right. like Iwo Jima.
We have a couple minutes for a few questions from the audience right here.
Hi, I'm Paul Shelton. I'm a high school teacher here in Cleveland. I'm interested especially in media narratives. And I think it was you, Mindy, talked about, well, now can he pivot, can Donald Trump pivot to more a presidential narrative or whatever. It doesn't seem like that's possible anymore. Like, once your media narrative is locked in, it's locked in. And so I'm just wondering about the possibility, not only of that, but how in new media can you actually let life happen, right? We know, for example, we're not the same people as at 25, at 35, at 45, and these kind of things. And how's media sort of allowing people to sort of grow and develop and their narrative to change?
Mindy, you want to start?
Sure. I think it is a challenge, but as rapidly as media moves and information flows, we also tend to be more forgiving. You know, there was this fear that initially, for any individual, frankly, that anything that was found about them online, you know, would live forever and would define them forever. And we're finding that's not necessarily true, because they have so many opportunities to get other images out there. And the same thing is true for candidates. You know, I don't think it's that easy when you have such a strong brand to turn it around. I mean, Hillary Clinton has a certain brand that's hard for her to turn around that's been solidified over decades. The same thing is true for Donald Trump. But it's not impossible if you make an explicit effort, just like any other brand, to shift and change your brand. You know, that is something that you can do.
One more over here.
Hi, David Paul with the Huffington Post. I'm struck by so many of these comments. It's really hard to know where to start. But on the comment that you just made about people being able to change their brand, I think Trump has shown such an extraordinary ability to brand other people in short order. And no place, with all due respect to Marco Rubio's experience, with nobody more than Hillary. If you look at her fave-on-fave ratings going back a year, she was about positive 15. Now she's negative 40. I mean, the ability that he has shown to use the social media to his advantage is extraordinary. It's hard to imagine how both at age 70 and succeeding in winning the White House doing it his way, that the notion that people are going to be able to come in and control him just seems mind-boggling.
Yeah, totally.
I think what we see is what we get. And it was reinforced last night by his son's comments. Forget data, we go with the gut. I mean, the gut tells you that what he's doing is working.
Yeah. Let me just make a couple points on that. So one of the mistakes I made at the beginning of this campaign was I underestimated the power of brand. I don't think it's any coincidence that the three front runners throughout this campaign were the three people that entered the race with pre-existing national brands: Bush, Trump, Clinton. Nobody else ever led a poll this entire race. And I don't think that's a coincidence. I think that is because it's very hard to build a brand in a competitive environment. And so Trump was very successful in branding some of his opponents because he had an outsized microphone and because he had an existing brand and the other people were undefined. And it was sort of a race to define themselves. And he was able to do it because he dominated the information flow throughout the campaign because of the outsized amount of media attention that he received. You mentioned Clinton. I don't actually give Trump credit for driving up her unfavorable ratings. I think that she sort of did it on her own, a combination of re-entering the political arena where for the first time in years she was there was a negative information flow headed her way from both Democrats and Republicans and, you know, investigative reporters, critical media. I don't think you can underestimate the impact that the FBI investigation has had on her because it's reinforced so many negative images with her. And so, you know, I think I don't credit him with driving it up. I think it's interesting that this convention so far is almost entirely about her and trying to reinforce those negatives. It's in part because it's the one unifying thing that the Republicans have right now. And it's in part because, amazingly, her negatives, as high as they are, aren't as high as Trump's yet. And I think to make this election truly competitive, he needs to get his negatives in line with hers. And the easier way to do it is to drive hers up rather than trying to bring his down.
I believe that's known as a race to the bottom.
Exactly. Well, picking up on that exactly is you have to have a willingness of a candidate to deliver that message personally, right? And his negatives are historically high. I mean, historically high. So he's nothing to lose, right? He can carry every single negative brand message he wants personally. Y'all have to cover it, right? Because it's a candidate. As a campaign, you want to get under your desk, but that's just the fact of Donald Trump. And he's not worried about his negatives rising beyond where they are because they can't. They're as high as he can possibly get. So he can brand everything and he can carry it himself and everybody has to cover it. I don't think that we've ever seen that in American politics before.
And with that, on that high note, I thank you guys all for coming. Thank you guys for coming. Thank you for sharing. Let's give a round of applause to our panelists, Josh, Alex, Mindy. Just a quick note, tomorrow morning's briefing, I know you guys love the donuts, come back for more tomorrow. We will talk about Trump's road to the White House and how he might get there. Ron Brownstein will be joined by Major Garrett, who of course is the chief White House correspondent for CBS News. And they will also be on stage with John Brabender, John Weaver, Sarah Fagan, and Mike Duhaime, all power players in 2016. Thank you guys for coming.